Carbon tetrachloride is basically chloroform's cousin, but one chlorine higher, and it's a really useful but very carcinogenic solvent which was once used in fire extinguishers, but nowadays it's almost inaccessible to the everyday bloke, which is just sad. The official reason for its almost international ban is the fact that it's a major ozone depleter. However, obviously the real reason is that the governments of the world are hoarding all the tasty carbon tetrachloride to themselves! Also, I really wanted to know how it smells, because it apparently smells sweet, and I like sweet things. So I'll be doing a smell test where I compare it to chloroform. To turn bleach into carbon tet, we first have to make a pit stop, and react the bleach with acetone to make chloroform, which we can then process further into the cancer juice. Chloroform has a nefarious reputation for being able to knock out anyone in just a single whiff of it. That, however, isn't true, as you'd have to put a chloroform-soaked rag over your face for around 5 minutes to actually knock yourself out. You can thank Hollywood for spreading this misconception, by the way. However, chloroform is pretty carcinogenic and toxic itself, so I guess it's good that common folk aren't eager to play with it. First, to start, I've measured out around a liter of 15% bleach, and this stuff is actually 3 times more concentrated than the household bleach you'd find in a mama's closet. Don't ask how I know. Ask her. It's so intense, in fact, that it bleaches clothes on contact, and when I first unpacked it, some managed to leak outside of the container, and it completely ruined my pants! Then I've transferred all the bleach into this plastic container, and then I've diluted it with a bunch of water. Then I've sloshed it around, and I've put it into a freezer until it reached sub-zero temperatures. The sub-zero temperature part is key. A few hours later, and the bleach is cooked to around -3°C. Then, in one fell swoop, I've added around 53 mL of acetone into the mix. Immediately, once I've added it, an exothermic reaction started happening where the acetone was being attacked by the bleach to form chloroform. Immediately I've put a cap on and started to vigorously shake it. The shaking part is necessary to avoid any local hotspots that might form. I've tried putting some ice cubes into the reaction vessel, but as you can see, the cap wasn't big enough. What's happening here is an exhaustive chlorination of acetone via sodium hypochlorite, and this carbon here is constantly being attacked by the bleach to replace other hydrogens attached to this carbon by chlorines. And once this substitution is completed, the carbon snaps off the molecule and picks up an additional hydrogen along the way, leaving chloroform, sodium chloride and the rest of that acetone chain. You can also make any other halogen form by this reaction as long as you have the bleach equivalent of that halogen. Next morning, after everything reacted, I poured off all the extra water. This water most likely had around 20 grams of chloroform dissolved into it, but I'm not going to go through the hassle of recovering it. In fact, I think it's actually impossible to do so. If there were to be chloroform, then it would be at the bottom of the container. That's because chloroform's density is much higher than that of water.
Oh shit.
This oily layer at the bottom is basically the chloroform, and now I have to use my separatory funnel to get a fine separation of the chloroform and water. Now technically it should be gold for the carbon tet prep, right? Well, you're wrong. You see, just as water can dissolve chloroform, chloroform can dissolve a little bit of water, which means this chloroform is currently wet, and this extra water could screw up the later reaction, so I've distilled it over a drying agent just in case. In the end, we're left with 50 grams of dry chloroform. Nice. Now usually people put some ethanol into the chloroform to stabilize it to prevent the formation of phosgene, which is a gas at room temperature that smells like musty hay and can poison you in a few whiffs. However, I did not do that. Oxidation of chloroform into phosgene can only happen under the presence of oxygen and UV, and besides the fact that oxygen here is literally trace, this is an amber glass bottle which was stored in my cupboard that was always closed and devoid of any light. Anyway, now that I have finally acquired the chloroform, I have proceeded to procrastinate on this project due to some school BS. However, eventually I've gotten some additional free time and I've decided to try my hand at making the cancer juice. The conversion of chloroform to carbon tetrachloride is very simple. All you have to do is pass chlorine gas through chloroform while it is being irradiated by UV light. This process is known as the photolytic chlorination, and as the name suggests, you need a strong UV source, and this is pretty much why my first attempt at making carbon tet failed. And in a nutshell, it was because of those shitty UV lamps, which are pretty much just normal incandescent lights, but with a purple filter that outputs extremely low amounts of UV radiation. And these people have the balls to call this piece of junk a UV lamp. And that's why I've decided to go on YouTube and I found this guy making carbon tet. And he used the xenon short arc lamp, which is sometimes used in car headlights, and he got a decent yield. So you know the saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I've got the same one he got. This xenon lamp is encased in the special glass tube, which blocks out any UV radiation produced by the lamp, which for our purposes makes this lamp practically useless. So I've used an angle grinder to open up the tube, and now this lamp can emit a lot of UV, and it technically has essentially turned into an artificial sun. That's because if you really think about it, the sun is just a big ball of plasma, and inside this lamp there is a high voltage electric arc which is also made of plasma. This experiment can also be done by using the little amount of UV that actually comes from the sun during the daylight. But for whatever reason, I'm quite often uncomfortable doing stuff outside, because my neighbors think I'm making drugs. To begin the carbon tetrachloride synthesis, into a 1000 ml free-necked boiling flask, I've added 35 grams of chloroform.
Alright guys, before we begin, I just want to say that this is really stupid. Don't ever do this, you will probably die if you do. Or give yourself cancer. I am currently turning on my hot plate. And I'm hoping for the best.
Once I've turned on the hot plate, the chloroform starts to boil. The vapors then travel into this condensing column I've set up, which turns the chloroform vapor back into a liquid. The chloroform then immediately drips back down into the reaction flask. When I was ready, I've added around 10 mL of hydrochloric acid to start my chlorine gas generator, which operates via this reaction. The chlorine gas immediately goes to my drying tube, which is filled with anhydrous calcium chloride. This ensures that the chlorine gas has no water, which could contaminate the reaction. Once I was pretty sure that the chlorine has displaced most of the air in the flask, which is crucial unless I want to have a very nasty war gas produced, I have turned on the lamp. You can see how intense it is, especially when I turn off my studio light. It first turns this greenish color, but then goes into this almost blinding white. I'm not really good at electronics, so I can't really tell you why that is happening. All I've really done is just fixed up the ballast and then hooked it up to my DC power supply. What's happening here is a photolytic chlorination of chloroform into carbon tetrachloride. Under UV light, the diatomic chlorine is split into chlorine radicals. This chlorine radical converts the carbon-hydrogen bond into a carbon-chlorine bond. Once that's done, the second chlorine atom, which was once part of the diatomic chlorine species, with the hydrogen, which was discarded from the chloroform after the bond cleavage, forms acidic hydrogen chloride gas. Now why is this so important to make sure there is no air in the apparatus? If there is air or more straightforwardly oxygen in the setup, then as I said before, a side reaction occurs where the chloroform is photolytically oxidized into phosgene. If phosgene is produced, it poses a huge danger to myself, because if I take even a single whiff, and even if it doesn't kill me, it can still severely injure me, because phosgene is an extremely dangerous chemical. At the beginning I kinda lied and I wasn't sure if there was enough chlorine there, so if there was oxygen when the UV was shining, then a little bit of phosgene production may have occurred. However, even though I acknowledge this may have been happening, that is an extremely unlikely scenario, because even though the chlorine may not have been visible, it could have still been there to displace the air. Also, I haven't removed the entire UV filter, so if you take this ugly paint drawing of the apparatus into consideration, the chloroform itself would have displaced the air from the apparatus where the UV was being shined on. Of course, you can believe whatever you want, but just know that I'm fine, so don't be a big mini in the comments. Eventually I've just kind of got fed up with the fact that I couldn't tell if chlorine was flowing into the apparatus, so I've kind of tilted everything to make sure the liquid was enveloped in the output. And as you can see by the bubbles, chlorine was indeed being produced. As the chlorination goes on, the chloroform turns this greenish color, which after turning on the UV lamp goes away. This is the telltale sign of chlorine being dissolved into the chloroform and then being reacted away. Now, I've had generated 2 moles of chlorine for 1 mole of chloroform, which would have theoretically translated into a smooth conversion. Due to my stuff being completely fucked, which is, let me explain, the fact that I have to manually operate my chlorine gas generator really ticked me off. This is not how it's supposed to be and it leads to short bursts of chlorine, which leads to an incomplete conversion. Or the carbon tet slash chloroform being pushed farther into the setup into the reverse funnel trap. Also, the reason that this video exists is because of this book here, which prompted this guy to make a video on carbon tet, which I've used as a resource. Of course, I've read the carbon tetrachloride chapter myself, and I'd like to pay my respects to this book. It's a valuable resource on preparing many hard-to-get reagents in a laboratory setting, and I encourage you to buy it, unlike me who just used Libgen. Here I've let the reaction vessel cool down and you can see how a white fuming vapor is oozing out of the reaction vessel. I've also tested this with a pH paper and turned red. Granted, this could be chlorine, but due to how thick and white those fumes were, I think it was some hydrochloric acid, which would mean that the desired reaction has happened. There was also a thought that crossed my mind that this was actually phosgene gas, but I'd rather not believe that. Anyway, eventually I've weighed it out and somehow we've lost around 5 grams from the general mixture. And I have no fucking idea where it went and it really freaking scares me to think where it actually went. However, it most likely either traveled into the gas trap or the actual input. That's because when chloroform was boiling, it generated enough pressure to actually condense in the dryer and the chlorine flask. One way to tell if our little science experiment worked is to test the density of the chloroform and the supposed carbon tetrachloride. Moving on, I've measured out around 10 mL of our supposed carbon tet, and its density is around 15 grams per 10 milliliters. Now let's check out the chloroform density, and it's a solid 14.74 grams per 10 milliliters. Now this is a really cheap scale, so I can't really expect great accuracy, but if our chloroform's density is 1.474 grams per milliliter, and the actual density of chloroform is 1.49 grams per milliliter, then it's safe to assume that the true density of the supposed carbon tetrachloride from 1.498 grams per milliliter to 1.502 grams per milliliter, which means that there was a 0.024 grams per milliliter difference. And that is really fucking small. Now, but for real, when I've done the math, I've actually went through a psychotic episode. Also, as a heads up, I did check on the Wikipedia what the carbon tet was supposed to smell, so I may suffer from a placebo effect. However, from what I remember, both samples' smells differed.
For what you can hear, probably birds are singing, and I'm going to be inhaling carbon tetrachloride. Bon appetit. Yeah. A typical smell. I love it. I hate it. I mean, should I really? Why did I do this stuff, man? Okay. Alright. If this is carbon tetrachloride, then it's much more sweet, I guess. I mean, I thought it was going to be terrible or something, but it's actually pretty vanilla, to be honest. Then I guess another whiff. Yeah, it's pretty much sweet, you know. I don't know. So fucking stupid, man. Also, he's...
Anyway, this is all. As I said, I probably come back to this because I'm very doubtful of this whole experiment. But don't worry, we'll figure out some way of making 100% carbon tet. Anyway, thanks for watching. This is the Prussian Blue Show. Make sure to like and subscribe. Bye.